What would you do if there was a child right in front of you?
Mother's all kinds of fucked up.
Do you wish Aikido was real? Do you like Mirror's Edge and Dead Rising? Well, joke's on you, because this game is just Dead
Island
plus Dark Messiah, except it's actually fun.
Sorry.
I've been aware of this game for a while because it's the fucking Coffee Cheetos Chicken game. However, I had always thought it was just a fucking another mainstream zombie game. But recently I thought, hey, this is the same studio that made Gunslinger. They know what fun is. I guess I'll check it out. And yeah, it turns out they still know what fun is. So sit back, relax, and get comfortable while we dropkick children, fall 50 feet into a pile of rusty knives and broken glass, and skip every cutscene. Dying Light is, like I said, a fucking another mainstream zombie game, so you already know what's going on here. This particular flavor of zombie apocalypse is the perfectly curable, but it's a government-engineered pandemic, so you need a rare and expensive medicine to temporarily stave off infection, but it doesn't actually matter because your infection moves at the speed of plot kind of flavor. Do you care? Me neither. Let's never talk about the plot again. The other important thing is that the title is wrong. You're perfectly fine in the light. It's the nighttime that brings out the volatiles. Luckily, they're role-playing as vampires or some shit, so they hate UV light. It doesn't seem to hurt them, they just get kinda shiny. This means that the remaining human safe houses are bathed in massive, cancer-causing ultraviolet lights. Dying light? More like dying slowly over time from metastatic melanoma. Hang on, I can't talk about the graphics yet. There's a bunch of shit on my screen. Alright, there we go. Thank fuck. Normally, I'd put a PC gaming wiki joke here. However, the default field of view is 102, which, honestly, is some GigaChad shit. Thank you, Pavel. Seriously, I'm tired of having to go into the config files to get an FOV above 65, because console players sit so far away from their TV that you'd need a fucking orbital baseline to create the minimum amount of measurable parallax. But yeah, this game runs like a dream, which is really important when the whole point of your game is its fast and fluid movement system. Now, apologies to Pavo, but I'm skipping over the art. It's competent, but apart from the volatiles, which I quite like, the environments, characters, and models are just bog fucking standard for the zombie genre. I will say that Pavel did a good job on the first-person cutscenes. The ones I didn't skip, at least. I really enjoyed Pavel's work on Gunslinger, and I am happy to report that he has brought his absolute best to the table yet again. I'm playing on the hardest difficulty, so I hit about as hard as I would in real life. But it doesn't sound that way. It sounds like I am a one-man zombie wrecking crew. It really sells that I'm not weak. These zombies are just tough bastards. But think about that for a second. This sound design is so good that even bullet sponges are satisfying to fight. To an extent, at least. We'll get to that. Trust me, we will fucking get to that. Pavel's other contribution to this game is the music. You'd expect the soundtrack for this kind of game to be somber, tense, suspenseful, and boring. But no, it's kind of like someone's running a Russian crack installer, but from another room. Which makes sense, because right now, you're running around, having fun, but you're only one slip up from death. The moments of peace are undercut by a feeling of sorrow and the knowledge that this is only a temporary respite. It reminds you, hey, these people are counting on you, so you gotta pick yourself up, get back out there, and do a bunch of fetch quests.
Alcohol? Yeah, I've got some alcohol. I've got the
Yeah, skipping all the cutscenes does strip the game of its context, and as discussed in the Gunslinger video, context is everything. But you know what? I don't care. Yes, I have just reduced all the quests to go here, do thing, and come back, but in this game, all three of those steps are really fun. The whole point of Dying Light, or at least the only thing I care about it, is its movement system. I don't know what you call this, the parkour? Free running? A really advanced version of the floor is lava? Whatever it is, it's fucking great. First-person platforming is often reviled due to games like Half-Life, where your hitbox is a big invisible rectangle, and bumping your fucking ankle is enough to completely miss a jump. However, it's actually quite easy to make this setup fun. You just make the front of the hitbox magnetically attracted to climbing points. Yes, I am massively oversimplifying all of Pavel's hard work, but bam, problem solved. Now a missed jump becomes a ledge grab, and you can vault over waist-high platforms instead of awkwardly crouch jumping. It is an absolute absolute joy to sprint through the world at Mach 5, ignoring the plot so I can hoard hundreds of ration packs for myself. It's not like I need them or anything, I just don't feel like going back to hand them in. Those children can stay hungry for all I care, I'm having fun, goddammit. Dying Light uses the standard array of special infected that we've all seen a million times before. You know, shamblers, sprinters, spitters, bombers, brutes, tanks, and superhuman night sprinters that might be an original idea? I'm hesitant to give credit for that though, given how ridiculously saturated the zombie genre is. Regardless, this standard zombie lineup works perfectly with the movement system. Fighting zombies is brutally difficult, or at least they want you to think it is. It's like fighting the IRS. You can probably beat one or two of them to death with a lead pipe, but they do not stop coming. You do not want to get bogged down, so you'll need to stay on your toes, avoid fights where you can, and scum your way out when you can. To do that, we'll need to get a bit creative, and use our experience to build up to the full moveset. Instead of a generic XP-based upgrade system, you have three separate trees that each gain experience individually. This system is great, it's a fresh take on a familiar concept in a game full of old ideas just thrown together. Survivor points serve as the generic XP for doing quests and minor objectives. They unlock various ways to, you guessed it, survive. Things like new crafting recipes, a really useless shield, zombie camouflage, and at the end of the tree, a fucking grappling hook. If you die, you'll lose a set amount of survivor points, because, you know, I'm sure you saw this joke coming from a mile away, but I guess you're a shitty survivor if you die. What's the deal with airline food? I can't do Jerry Seinfeld. Agility XP is gained by bouncing off everything in sight like a second grader on his first dose of Adderall. It unlocks even more ways to climb on everything and everyone in sight. But more importantly, it lets you share the joys of flight with everyone around you. Power XP is gained by dealing damage and getting kills. It unlocks a bunch of boring damage upgrades, but also finisher moves for downed or stunned enemies. And yes, I said enemies, not zombies. You are so inconceivably jacked that you can kick a grown man's entire head into fucking paste. Once you unlock the important parts of your moveset, combat goes from a slog to an absolute joy. You aren't, I don't know, Ash Williams? Brad Pitt? What's a pop culture reference for some big guy who just kills zombies and doesn't afraid of anything? Fucking Sam B? Whatever, zombies are best avoided, and the combat does a great job reflecting that. It's like Jackie Chan in Mirror's Edge of Zombieland. You can grapple zombies into traps or off cliffs, knock them over for an instant kill, or use firecrackers to bait them into the absurd number of environmental hazards. This lockdown started like a month ago. Who the fuck had the time to run around Mad Maxing everything? Anyway, you are meant to avoid combat where possible. This is why I love the XP system. If you just got generic points to spend on whatever you want, it'd encourage zombie farming, which would clash horribly with the incentives to avoid combat. If zombie farming just didn't give XP, there would be zero point in fighting, so they'd quickly become an absolute nuisance. With power and agility in separate trees, you're rewarded for both running away and sticking around to fight. And with survivor points in their own third category, you'll always get some kind of reward, even if you somehow manage to miss any of the 7 billion conditions that cause these amazing dopamine-releasing XP pop-ups to appear.
Back away. This doesn't concern you.
You wanna bet?
What is this shit?
The level designers are utter, absolute, unrepentant bastards. Why would I say that? Are the levels bad or something? No, they're actually quite good. The open world freerunning has a beautiful sense of flow. They also just casually aced the firefight levels, despite the rest of the gameplay being completely antithetical to that kind of fighting. I guess I shouldn't be surprised that the gunplay is fun, cause, you know.
Is that the best you got, Ryze? I can do this all fucking day!
Oh, that is not the best you got.
So yeah, the level designers know exactly what they're doing. It's just that they're bad people. Surely I can't assess someone's moral character just from the levels they made, right? Well, take a look at this.
Are you fucking kidding me?
Sure, yeah, that was an idiot trap and I fell for it, but you're an asshole for putting it there. How about this one?
You motherfucker!
What was the point of that? Seriously, what was the fucking point of that? They put a checkpoint right there. They knew you'd die to it. They literally just did that to kill you. Why the fuck? That one pissed me off pretty bad, so I started paying more attention and stopped falling for that kind of trap. And I guess the game didn't like that because it started spawning them right behind me. And when that didn't work, it spawned two right on top of me. And that isn't even the worst of it. Okay, the game introduced a new enemy with zero fanfare and gives you about a second to react before. I mean, yeah, that's annoying, but how is that the worst one? Because 20 seconds, literally 20 seconds later, you get this. You see that? You're given a safe vantage point as the game demonstrates what this new enemy is and how it works. That is like textbook game design. That is exactly how Half-Life 2 introduced its man hacks. Why the fuck would you? You know what? I don't care. Fuck you, Pavel. Oh, there's no Pavels in level design. 46, in case you were wondering. 46 people named Pavel worked on Dying Light. And no, I have no idea how to pronounce it. I'm just going off this video.
Pavel.
Now, I said we wouldn't talk about the plot, but we will talk about the writing. I wouldn't normally do it like this, but this game has the most astoundingly bizarre writing that I've ever seen in my entire life. Like, look at this. This will heal you, but don't be surprised if you get the urge to eat some granola afterward. What is that supposed to mean? What kind of joke is that? Is that even a joke? Is it about vegans? Am I gonna turn into a fucking squirrel? What? Or Molotovs. Not to be confused with the drink of the same name served in bars. That's just not how you do that joke. It's supposed to go like, the Molotov, not to be confused with the Molotov, a popular cocktail served in bars. You know, you're supposed to say the thing twice to indicate that you can get those two things confused. Whatever, I'm done overanalyzing. Here's a few of my favorites. Please feel free to explain what the fuck any of these mean.
Aye, aye, Commander.
This ain't the Navy, son. Drink some coffee and sober up.
The fuck did that mean?
Make your own lunch, you Cliff Notes intellectual.
Cliff Notes intellectual. Cliff Notes intellectual. The fuck does that mean?
Run, train, run. It's what you slaves are good at, right? Run or die.
What the fuck was that supposed to mean? It's what you good snakes are good at. Snakes don't run, dumbass. They don't have fucking legs.
See, defeat a couch potatoes guy to vegetable guy. That's the one.
That was a fucking Sneed joke.
Crane, the player character, is decently personable.
Fucking mountains.
But he is an absolute idiot, and I have no idea if it's intentional or just bad writing. There's little things like dunking his entire head underwater to pick a lock like 3 feet off the ground, or the zombie camouflage move where he rubs infected zombie blood directly into his fucking eyes. However, the big thing is that he's supposed to be a secret agent, but he uses his real name. I picked up this game after rewatching Tesnaker's video for the upteenth time, and he pointed this out too. I thought he was joking, or that it didn't matter. But no, it's a fucking plot point. The bad guy just looks you up on Google. What? And while I'm on the subject, the bad guy is so boring. He desperately wants to be on those top 10 best villains of all time videos, but he can't stop spitting out dumb villain tropes that we've all seen a million times.
All of this, and still you had your choice made for you. Disappointing, Crane.
Ah, yeah, would you kindly kill yourself?
You.
Fuck off.
Get in there and kill them.
Yes, you don't make choices because he's a fucking player character. I make his choices. Fuck off.
There's this whole extended scene that you can't skip for some reason, where someone, I skipped the cutscenes, I don't know who this is, but both of you are minutes away from zombification, and the bad guy throws you one vial of anti-zombie drugs. So the game really plays up about how she sacrifices herself for Crane and even gives you this dream sequence where he hallucinates closure for her. And all I can think is, man, those poor Pavels. They put so much work into a scene that we've all fucking seen before. Then she goes zombie mode on a dude and you fucking...
I don't know who this person is. Let me skip the cutscenes, please. Don't just take that away from me halfway.
And that gives the bad guy a hard-on, I guess? His boss fight is just a quick time event, you know, because otherwise it'd be over in 2 seconds. And I'll admit, he got me a few times. Not because it was hard or anything, but because it was so fucking boring. Luckily, beating it gives you one of the best lines in all of gaming.
Prove you are a man! Just take your vengeance!
Will you just shut the fuck up?!
At this point, you can probably tell that this game is far from perfect. Most elements either fail to line up with or actively clash against each other. The plot wants to be tense, it wants to be urgent, but it's a free roamer. It fundamentally cannot be urgent. like it gives you 48 hours to stop the city from getting bombed, then awkwardly looks the other way as you spend an in-game week picking flowers. Does the tone want to be tense and somber, like the situation is dire and we're only surviving by the skin of our teeth? Does it want to be goofy and have fun, since this is inherently a fun game where dropkicks are a valid solution to any problem? Or does it want to be both? The music straddles this line perfectly, but that's just because musicians are way better than writers at communicating emotion. The plot is boring enough to make me skip the cutscenes, and the gameplay is fun enough to survive being stripped of context. And honestly, that's okay. Not every game can be a winner. However, I'm still gonna complain about the bad stuff because bitching about video games is my therapy. First of all, lockpicking. Fuck this shit. It's the exact same system from Fallout 3 and every Bethesda game since then. The thing is, those games are RPGs, where you can change the minigame by upgrading your lockpicking skill. The minigame in Dying Light never changes. It's just a tedious waste of your time. And of course, those Bethesda games had the common decency to pause the game while you're stuck lockpicking. Dying Light has no such chivalry. Combat starts out decently fun, but there's a few things that become grating very quickly. Sprinters and humans can dodge attacks, and it is the fucking worst. They just telekinetically negate your attack whenever they feel like it. On top of that, normal zombies can do this stumbling forward animation where they ignore hit stun and just grab you. Yeah, I said combat is discouraged, and this is a big reason why. It's fucking horseshit. If you make too much noise while you're out and about, you'll attract the nearby runners, who come pouring out from the woodwork to kick your ass. This is supposed to represent loud noises attracting distant zombies, but it is terribly executed. In practice, the game just spawns runners in a radius around you, and if they can't reach you, they spawn right on top of you. But toast, I hear you cry. That's clearly meant as your cue to run away. Of course you'll get overwhelmed if you stay still, and you raise a good point, one that you should take up with the quest and encounter designers. Most quests require you to interact with a bunch of stuff. I mean, that's true for any game, but Dying Light has these obnoxiously long first-person animations, so sometimes you are forced to clear out an area so dipshit Supreme Kyle Crane can really take his time flipping those bodies over. The problem is that a lot of quests will just plop down a big guy right next to where you need to be, and both flavors of big guy are awful to fight. They have way too much health, and can't be ragdolled or stunned, so no insta-kill moves. And the biggest guys throw rocks so well that it's like trying to play TF2.
I'm gonna fucking kill myself, holy shit.
I would be totally fine with all of this if the guns were just reliable. But no, they are depressingly weak. The enemy scaling gets to a point where zombies and humans alike can tank multiple headshots. Emphasis on can, because the damage is completely fucking random. Also, since your moveset is based around quickly singling out and eliminating foes and balanced around your lack of crowd control, this game is not capable of traditional boss fights. I'd write a section about this fucker right here, but I think I did a pretty good job describing him in the moment.
What a terribly programmed video game. Ah yes, I'm a bad survivor because all of my gear teleported out of my fucking pockets during a cutscene. I can't just, no, I can't leave. God damn it, I have to fight this shit boss that knocks you over with every hit and none of your special moves work against him. And you have no items, no gear, and he dodges and blocks fucking 75% of your attacks. Cool, great. What the fuck?
I wanted to talk about the expansion, but I don't have much to say. I'll make it quick. Dying Light, the following, comes with the enhanced edition that's cheaper than the base game for some reason. It takes place right after the base game. Truly, Dying Light, the following. Except this time, the map sucks. Because now we have driving, so the new map needs to be wide and flat to accommodate it. It just takes away all that fun platforming stuff I liked from the base game. There's a goth girl teen drama that I found really fucking funny, complete with a, "My God, these bitches gay! Good! Good for them!" The basic setup of having to do side quests to advance the plot was pretty great, since ignoring the plot to do side quests is what I was going to do anyway. It still tries to feign urgency by telling you to hurry, but at least it doesn't throw in a fake time limit again. The volatile nests were a neat idea, although I did cheese a few of them by just repeatedly throwing myself into them until I got the, whatever these are. Ew. The bosses sucked, fuck all of these. And finally, I found the writing intriguing enough that I actually watched a few cutscenes without skipping them. Overall, I kinda hate the map for making me drive everywhere, but the quest design and writing was definitely a step up from the main game.
He just fell out of the map.
So that was Dying Light. It's not perfect, but I really enjoyed the movement system and Dark Messiah kind of take on zombie combat. Until it got tedious, at least. Dying Light 2 is already out, but it's pretty expensive right now, so I'm just gonna wait. Thank you for watching. This video didn't come out as fast as I wanted it to, but, you know, c'est la vie, c'est la vie. Fuck the French, I don't care. If you enjoyed this video, you know, please help it on the algorithm. Spread it around, like the video, or leave a comment. Even if it's something stupid like a smiley face, I do actually enjoy reading those. And if you want to see more videos, subscribe. And if you really want to see more videos, I have a Patreon, YouTube membership program, and a Ko-fi account. Special thanks to these lovely people on screen. It's getting to the point where I can't just copy-paste the list into a fucking text box. I have to, like, order it, and I don't know what to do. Do the people that paid more want, like, a bigger name? I don't know what to do. I figured I would cross that bridge when I had to, and I kind of have to. I record these before I have to edit it, so we'll see if I figured something out. Regardless, love you, bye.